All right. Well, thank you everyone for joining in today on day two of Apex Hours for Students. First of all, sorry for the technical glitch, but nevertheless, better late than never, right? So thank you again, and welcome to this day two of Apex Hours for Students. Today we have a very interesting session, which is about data modeling as to how you can model your data on Salesforce. So I'm not going to be talking a lot about what data modeling is because we already have our speaker who's ready to go. So without wasting any further time, I'd like to welcome our speaker for today, Atul Rajguru, who's an accomplished architect. And I will, just hand it over to Atul now. Atul, it's all yours. You can steal the show now.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you, Jigar, for this nice introduction. Good morning, good evening, everyone, wherever you are. Sorry for the delay. So today is the second day. I think yesterday Jigar covered the basics of Salesforce and what Salesforce is. Today we are going to focus majorly on the data modeling. So like what is data modeling and how to, work with Salesforce, how to create your database structures and ER diagrams and related activities into Salesforce. Then we'll also see some of the interesting features of Salesforce, specifically in terms of when we create our data model, right? So Jigar have already covered most of the part. I am Atul Rajguru. I'm working as a senior technical architect, and I am community speaker. I have done certain certifications. So moving on to agenda. So what we want to talk about today, we want to talk about like the convention database that we know, and then how Salesforce, use the similar kind of mechanism and similar kind of concepts to store the data, right? Then we are going to talk about the standard and custom objects. We will also talk about the fields or columns in our tables or objects. Then we'll talk about the relationship between two tables, right? So I believe most of you are from the engineering background, or even if you are not, then you might have seen the Excel sheets and use VLOOKUPs and functions like that, right? Where you relate one particular sheet or one particular table from sheet A to sheet B, right? So those kind of relationship we are also going to take a look at. And then we'll also touch base about the schema builder, which is really interesting feature of a Salesforce that allows you to visually represent your data model. So let's move on. I think we have already gone through this slide yesterday, so I'll not spend much time here. So let's talk about the objects, right? So when we say object in Salesforce, it's nothing but a table, okay? So if you have interacted with any of the database system like Oracle, SQL Server, FoxPro, or anything, any of the database in the world, so there you have a concept like it's a storage basically given to us, and then there we can store our data, right? So it's like there are rows and there are columns, and it's a sort of matrix. So there we store our data. In Salesforce, we have objects for same purpose, right? So whenever we talk about tables, it's just object in Salesforce. We can use them to store our data for persistent, right? If our system goes down, or in general, like database terms, whenever we use table, we in Salesforce, we can use objects. Okay. So there are a few additional properties. Those are made available to you when you create objects. So for example, certain fields get automatically added when you create objects, okay, or tables. So it's not just like what you define, but Salesforce on to manage that data, Salesforce also provides some housekeeping stuff to you, and then those become your column. So we'll talk about them. We'll see in live demo like how to create objects and how to interact with them. So we'll talk about the standard and custom objects. Okay, so there are two types of objects. So as Jigar was explaining earlier that there are few out of box available features and stuff to us as admins, right? So for example, accounts, your orders, right, your products. So all those tables are already available in Salesforce, and we can create our own objects or our own table in Salesforce. So whatever we create, that is called as a custom. Whatever Salesforce give us out of box, that is like it comes readily available to you. All those things or all those objects are called as a standard object, right? So how do you differentiate between these two, right? How do you know that this particular object is custom and this particular object is standard? So I have given here, differences between these two. So standard objects are out of box. Custom object, we can define ourselves. The custom objects, when we define, it gets __C as the API name, in the API name appended to it, so that it clearly denotes that this particular object is developed by somebody else or somebody not from Salesforce, right? There are the custom objects, as we create them, we get full control over them, right? How they are related with other objects. And when we use the standard object, there are certain limitations on us because there is already functionality built on those standard object, right? So for example, if you consider case, right? So case is the standard object where we log our customer's complaint. So there are already certain pieces of functionality which are already developed, and not to make sure that this functionality do not get disrupted due to the changes that we are doing, Salesforce limit us in a certain way so that we do not make accidental changes to this standard object. The examples I have given here, account, contact, user, these are standard object, right? Employee, department, invoices, right? These are sort of example of custom object, right? So now we'll talk about the fields type. So we talked about the tables, right? But table is just the like matrix, right? Matrix. So what are columns? So columns are defined by the field type. So whenever we create a field in a object, it becomes a column in your table, right? So these are the different field types. Those are available to us. And then there are few more. For the sake of simplicity, I have made sure that I have sort of classified these field types based on their nature. So for example, in blue, you can see auto number, which is like the number automatically get incremented. If you add few more like record, as you add record to your table or object, the auto number field will automatically get incremented. Checkbox is just like normal checkbox. Currency is where you can store numerical currency values, and date time. These are all like if you just read through them, those are all sort of self-explanatory. There are few which are interesting. Those I would like to highlight. So for example, pick list and pick list multi-select, right? So pick list is like your drop down, and pick list multi-select is where you can select multiple values in that drop down, right? Then text area long means you can store really large data, probably email, complete your email. Then rich text area, where you can store HTML formatted text, right? And URL, where you can store website URL and stuff like that. There is this orange or maroon section is specifically most interesting, and we'll see couple of the examples of this fields creating of this, and then our major focus is going to be on this area. Okay, so formula fields are very interesting. Okay, so when we create a formula, what it means is like in Excel you might have use functions, right? So where you have column A, B, C, and then in column D, if you want sum of column A, B, C, you can just put a function and then it will automatically calculate that sum, and then you can drag and drop in that Excel column so that the particular function get applied to all the rows, right? So same kind of functionality is available to us using the formula field. Formula field, you know, help us in automation. So for example, if we have a student table and in that student table, we have various subjects and for each subject, we are storing mark, right? So if you want to calculate total, if you want to calculate percentage, all those things we can do via using formulas, right? Rollup summary is again interesting. So rollup summary, we'll actually see a demo of this. But then just to give you summary, like if you have a parent and child table, right, you can have a summary on the parent table, right? So there you can roll up the values from your child table and then show the summary. Like you can show sum of the all child values, sum of all average of all child values, right? Count of child values. So those kind of things, interesting things we can do with a roll up summary. Lookup relationship is again one of the very interesting feature of Salesforce. So in database terms, we use a foreign key, right? So foreign key to refer the other table or a row in the other table, right? So same way we have a lookup in Salesforce. So we can create a lookup relationship on between object so that we know that this particular record from table, let's say invoice line item is related to this specific invoice and stuff like that. So we will see this in action. Master detail is where you set the parent and child. So lookup is very loosely typed relationship, right? So there is just a reference of the record that you are interested in lookup relationship. In master detail, there is a parent-child relationship. So your child record cannot exist. It is more strict in a nature. So we'll see more detail about this, but then just to give you a high level idea, like it's a relationship which is more strict than your lookup relationship. Text encrypted. So if you want to store something which is sensitive in a nature, so for example, credit card numbers or your Aadhaar card number, right? Those kind of information is can be encrypted so that nobody will be able to view that unless we give them a specific permission, right? And then there are hierarchical relationship, geolocation. So we'll see some of these in live demo, right? And then there are a few more relationships, those for the sake of, you know, like giving you guys an introduction and then avoid complexity at, at the initial level. We are not discussing them right here, but then there is a documentation and reference link provided at the end, which will help you to address specific, if you want to know more about specific field, then you will be able to search them and then understand their capabilities and then use them in a live project. Okay. So relationship, as I was talking about lookup and master detail. So here are, you know, differences, like the contrast between master detail and lookup. So lookup is like, just to link between two objects, right? Parent-child is, master detail is parent-child kind of relationship. So when I say parent-child, it means that your child record cannot exist unless you create your parent record, okay? So there is that bind, like compulsion comes in picture with master detail, and it helps us to develop certain type of application. So we will see this in live demo. So it's not just restriction, it also gives us certain capability. So we'll talk about that in our demo. Okay. When we delete the reference record, right? So for example, if I have, let's say, case, I have on a case, there is a case table, right? And then on that case table, I have a reference of let's say associated user. Okay, so I can sort of if I disable that user, then the case will not get affected. That record will not get affected. Okay, but if the relationship is master detail, then what will happen is like if I delete the child record, right? If I delete the parent record, the child record will be automatically get deleted, right? The capability that I was talking about when we use master detail is like we can have a roll up summary. So for example, the example that I was talking, like if you have, sort of table. So we have a demo for this, and then I'll show you how roll up summary help us. But then just to give you idea, like if you have a invoice table and then invoice line item table, right? So invoice line item is like your, if you go in a grocery shop and purchase 10 items and then total bills comes to like 100 rupees, right? So the 100 rupees will be a summary of all the items that you have purchased, right? Every item will have its own price, its own quantity. And based on that multiplication, you'll get the subtotal for that specific item, right? And then when you sum all that, you'll get the final number, right? So that is roll-up summary. Detail record must have a master record, right? So whenever you want to create child, you must have the master record. In the case of lookup, we don't have those sort of restriction. The detail record inherit the sharing. So we will, this specific topic is just for the specific point is mentioned just for the sake of completeness. We will see probably on a day 7, we have a session for sharing and visibility. So there we will see and understand this specific concept in more detail. And then we can create only 2 master detail fields on a particular custom object. Okay. And lookup, we can create 25. So these are the considerations for when you decide your data model, when you create your ER diagram, right? That time we need to make sure that how many master details we are using and how many lookups we are using. Okay. So we will talk about the next type of field, next type of feature that I would say, that is dependent pick list, right? So dependent pick list is, so for example, if you want to implement a feature like when user select a country, all states should be listed, right? So if we select a country as a India, it will list all states in India. If you select a state, it will list down all the cities in that state, right? So there is this dependency between two sets of field, right? So all those things can be done without writing any sort of code or taking any special effort. You just need to know certain things, and if we get enough time, we'll walk you through, you know, how to create a dependent pick list and which field can be a controlling field and stuff like that. But just for now, just understand that standard pick list. So there are pick list values which are standard out of box available to us on a Salesforce, right? So for example, when we have an opportunity object, right? On the opportunity object, we have open, we have close, close won, close lost. This kind of a pick list values, right? So those standard pick list values can be controlling field. So they can be parent sort of in a relationship, but they cannot be dependent. So the state, country, city pick list I was talking, right? So state becomes your controlling field and the country becomes your controlling field and city becomes your dependent field, right? So standard fields always can be a controlling field, but they cannot be a dependent field. Custom pick list, again, it can be a controlling field or it can be a dependent field. Multi-select, it cannot be a controlling field. So we cannot have like multi-select pick list as a controlling field, but it can be a dependent field. So in a multi-select pick list, out of 100 values, if you want to show 10 value for option A, different 10 value for option B, you can do that. Okay. Standard checkbox can be a controlling field, but cannot be on a dependent side. Custom checkbox, again, same, can be a controlling field, but cannot be a dependent field. Okay. So this is about the dependent pick list and dependent pick list value. So schema builder will see live in demo. Right? So schema builder allows you to interact with the schema of your application, or when we create a ER diagram, right? We use tools like Microsoft VCO, or there are a few other.
Hey, thank you, Atul. So let me just quickly show you how to create a data model in Salesforce with the help of a real world example. So let me just switch over to my hotel reservation screen. And let me just quickly walk you through a problem statement. So we're going to be creating a data model for within Salesforce for a hotel with the help of an hotel reservation example. So UC Resorts intends to manage the room reservations for hotels across various states using Salesforce. And so this particular resort has multiple hotels. What we're going to quickly do is create some of these entities. So some of the key entities that go into hotel reservation module would be hotel. Of course, there would be a room which would be reserved. And then you would also need to track reservations, which would be associated with a person, which would be a combination of contact and rooms. So let's just quickly go over and start creating these objects, and I can help you understand. So, the nitty-gritties of data modeling in Salesforce. So the first thing is to go out and create a hotel. So let me just switch my screens to my Salesforce instance quickly. And I'm going to share my screen now. All right, so here I am logged into my Salesforce Developer Edition org. I'm going to go to the setup menu and I'm going to look for the Object Manager. Object Manager is the place which helps you create or build objects, right? It's only available in Lightning Experience. If you're using Classic, the Object Manager may not be available. If you're not very comfortable using the Object Manager, you can also go to Objects and Fields and, you know, basically use the Object Manager option from here. So how do you create objects? So the first thing is to go and create the outline for our hotel reservation module. So let's clearly build out the objects, the key entities in our modeling example, which is a hotel, a room, and a reservation. We will not rebuild or create a custom object for a contact, because contact is something which is readily available within Salesforce, and we intend to use the standard Salesforce object of contact. Okay, hotel rooms and reservations are not readily available, hence we will have to custom define these objects. In turn, we will be building using custom objects for these. So let's just quickly go and build the hotel room and reservation objects. So let me just switch over to the Salesforce instance. Hopefully you guys are able to see my screen. Let me go to the Object Manager. Let me first create my hotel object. So let's start with creating a hotel object. Now, if you want to create, Object Manager basically is the directory of all the objects that exist on your org. If you want to search for a particular object, you can just type in quick find and you can locate a particular object. Right. In this case, we're going to create a custom. So we say create in custom object. That brings me to the new custom object screen. I'm going to quickly say hotel, because that's the name of the hotel. And I'm going to give it a plural label, hotels. Rest of the room. So because hotels do have a name, I'm going to keep a text field for a hotel name. You can also have the name set to an auto number, which will auto increment every now and then. We will see in a bit how you can use names as auto numbers, right? So for now, I'm going to leave it as text, right? And leave the default options as it is and just say save. Now, one of the key things to understand over here is if you check these check boxes over here, then only will you, the object be available for reporting. You can allow activities, basically allows you to track activities against a specific record. And then you have Salesforce auditing, which is field history tracking. And only if you check this particular checkbox, the field history tracking is available for this particular object. So right now we're going to just leave it as default, clean and simple, and just move on. So I'm going to say save and new, which will again bring up the same screen and help create the a new custom object. So in this case, the next object that I'm going to be creating as my slide deck here is going to be the room. So I'm going to switch back and say room, right? The plural is going to be rooms. Just leave the object name as it is. Now in this case, rooms usually have a number, right? And that is where we would use the standard name field, but in this case we will rename it to room number and we will use it as an auto number. Now once you start using an auto number, you can define the format in which you want to auto num you want to use your auto numbering format. In this case I'm going to say RM, and I know that my hotel's not very big, so I'm just going to keep it as three places, three digit numbered, and I'm going to start my number at one. So basically I'm saying, this is what I'm saying, that my room number or my order number, my room number field is going to for use follow the format RM hyphen in curly braces. This is not mandatory, but you know, that's the general convention. You can use all the other formats. You can just click on this and try to find out what are the available formats. The next tells me what are the starting numbers. So I'm going to use 001. Again, I'm going to use, let me keep all the other things as default, right? And again, I'm going to say save and new. The only reason why I say use save and new is just helps me become more productive and saves a lot of time and reduces my clicks. Now, the third object that we're going to create is reservation. These are the three custom objects of our example. So I'm going to say reservation. A reservation demarcates the booking of a particular room, and I'm going to say reservations, right? Leave rest of the stuff as it is. Now, usually when you do reservations, reservations are a number. So I'm going to say reservation number, and then I'm going to say RES. And see, I could have a lot of reservations. So I'm going to say 00000. Is the starting number. Again, I leave the default as it is, right? And this time, instead of save and new, I say save. Now, the only reason why I do that is now I return back to the object manager. And if I go to the object manager, I'd see that all our objects are in place. So we have a hotel object, we have a room object, and we have a reservation object. Now, one of the key things to note over here is all the object names, we did not provide any suffixes, but all the object names have a suffix which is automatically added, and it's _C. This is one of the key differences between a standard and custom object, that whenever you create a custom object, it's automatically suffixed with __C, which demarcates that it is a custom object. So just by looking at the API name of an object, you can figure out whether it's a standard object or a custom object. So let's just now go down to detailing of these things. So, now, first of all, let's understand the relationship. Now, all these objects, we just created these objects. All these objects are actually associated with each other. That's where the relational modeling comes in. So how do I understand or the relational modeling? So if you look at Salesforce, it gives you two basic types of relationships. One is a master detail, which is where the detail or the child records, the parent records are mandatory for a child record. Every child record, and a lookup where the parent is not mandatory. Now, in this particular case or in this particular scenario, I could have, I could never ever have a room which exists on its own. A room always has to be associated with a hotel, and that's the reason in this case, hotel would be the master and the room would be the detailed record. So hence they share a parent-child relationship. So the first thing is what we're going to do is we are going to detail out the hotel fields. And one of the key, so let's just, we've already created the name field, right? That's standard out of the box, and we're going to use that. But one of the key things that we can look at is creating a street address, which is a simple text field where somebody can type in the street address of a hotel. So let's just go and start creating the fields. Now, how do you go and create fields for an object? So you can go to the object manager, search for the respective object. In this case, it's going to be hotel. And once I click the name of the object, I am redirected to this particular tab. This is all the metadata associated with every object on the Salesforce instance. I'm going to choose fields and relationships. And then from there, I'm going to start detailing it out. Now, this also provides a quick find where I can search for a specific field if I have a lot of fields to take it out from. In this case, I'm going to keep it simple and say new field, and I'm going to call it street address. So first, we got to choose a data type. Because it's a plain text field, I'm just going to say text and just move on. Right, there are 16 or 18 odd data types which you can really explore. So I'm going to say street address. I'm going to provide a label. I'm going to provide that default length. So I'm going to say 255. And then I'm going to say street address is mandatory, right? I do not want to provide any duplicate values. I'm not worrying about that right now. So I'm just going to keep it simple, plain stock standard, move over to next. So now this screen really tells me who is able to see this field that we're creating. For now, we'll not get into the security nitty-gritties, and I'll just keep it as default. I say move on and say next. And then so every object has a page layout associated with it. A page layout is nothing but the user interface of every object, which is generated by default on the Salesforce platform. So it automatically also gets added to the hotel layout, and we'll see in a while as to how you can, how this field gets added to the layout. So I say save and new. The only reason is I'm a bit lazy and I'm going to just reduce my clicks. So the next field as per our object model defined in the slide deck is state and city. Now, one of the key things about state and city is we would want these to be pick lists, but also we would want to have the city field to have a dependency on the respective state field, which means that when I choose a specific state, only the relevant cities of that specific state should be displayed, which is a very logical behavior that the user would expect, right? And that's where the dependent pick list thing comes in. So let's just understand how to create simple dependent pick lists within Salesforce. So we're going to go back to our hotel object. And right, we're already on the hotel object. If you want to check, this is the name. I'm going to say a pick list, right? And I'm going to say next. Okay, we're going to say state, right? And I'm not going to use a global pick list value. I'm going to explicitly provide my own values. So I'm going to keep it simple. I'm going to add three states. Maharashtra, Karnataka, guys, don't really crucify me if I get the spellings wrong. I'm usually bad at spellings. So we're going to get three states. You can do all the fancy stuff over here. You can say that if there is a default value that is already chosen amongst this, if you choose this, there is no default value which is already selected. Sometimes it's a good idea to have the default value selected. Just choose the default value to be the most common value. That way it eases out the overhead of providing inputs to the form by your users and saves them a ton of effort. You want to restricted to a defined value set. Yes, we do want to, we don't want people to go and add values, so we're going to keep it to this, to that particular thing. We don't want to alphabetically sort this, but if there is any alphabetical sort required, yeah, you can just do it with this click. I'm going to keep the rest of the things as same and just move on. I'm very liberal in my thoughts, and hence I would want everybody to see my field. Ideally, that's not the true way. You will of course have a security model. I'm going to also add this to my page layout. And then, so I have built the country pick list. Now what I'm going to do is save a new, and I'm going to choose another field, and this is going to be a city pick list. Let's say pick list, say next, then go to city. Again, like I said, I want to put my own values. So I'm going to say Mumbai, Pune, Bangalore, Mysore. We have all heritage hotels, so we're going to not miss out on Jaipur and Udaipur. All right. Rest of the things remain the same, and then I'm going to say next. I want everybody to see this field, so I'm just again going to click next. If you don't want to make sure that this field is added to the layout, okay, just uncheck. But in this case, I do want it to be added, so I'm just going to keep it the way it is, and just say save instead of saving new. Now, if you go and see your HODL object, there will be certain fields that will be created. But one of the key things that we talked about was the state and city dependency pick list. What we're going to do, we're going to go and say field dependencies. And once the field dependency screen loads, I'm going to say new. And now there are two things when you're defining, when you're defining dependency, dependent pick lists. One of the key things, there are always two things. One is a controlling field and the other is a dependent field. Controlling field in our case is going to be state here, because your, and the dependent field is something that loads the values based on the values selected in the controlling field. So in our case, the dependent field is going to be a city. Right, fairly simple, straightforward, and I'm going to say continue. Now, once I define which is the controlling field and which is the dependent field, I got to go and map the values. So I'm going to map it based on my geographical understanding. Mumbai, Pune fall in Maharashtra, Bangalore. Sorry about that. You're going to keep pressing the control button while you click. So you say Bangalore and Mysore reside or exist in Karnataka, and then of course Jaipur and Udaipur in Rajasthan. Now this mapping signifies that whenever I choose state as Maharashtra, only Mumbai and Pune should display as the relevant options, and the remaining cities should not be shown. Same way for Karnataka and same way for Rajasthan. So let's, if you've already made the selection, we'll say include values, and then we will say a good idea here is to preview. So we just take a quick preview. Right now there's nothing selected. Let's say if I select Maharashtra, you have Mumbai and Pune. If I select Rajasthan, now Mumbai, Pune don't show up, and instead it's just Jaipur and Udaipur. So this is just a preview, just to make sure that whatever you mapped is working as desired. Now I'm going to go and save. Right, and that's exactly how you would establish field or establish dependency between fields on an object. This state and city was a great example of for creating dependent pick lists within Salesforce. Now let's quickly move back and start detailing the room object. Now the room object is a special object purely because it's a part of a master detail relationship, and the room would be the child of a hotel. Purely because a room cannot exist on its own. So I'm going to create the room object now. And so I go back to the object manager tab. I'm going to search for rooms now. I already have the room object. So I'm going to start creating fields on the room object. So let me just switch back to my slide deck and see what are the fields. So we have a couple of fields. We have hotel, which is a parent, which we have tariff, which could be what's the amount for, what's the tariff for that room per night, and the type of room, which is typically what are the occupancy of that room. So let's just create these fields. So go back to the room object and say new. I'm still using the object manager. So I'm going to say new, and I'm going to say master detail. Okay. The reason why master detail, because we're going to be pointing to the hotel object in this case, and it's going to ask us which object do we want to point to. Of course, it's a no-brainer. It's going to be hotel. So I'm going to quickly search, say hotel, say next. Keep the name same. And then, of course, so the relationship in Salesforce has a name. Rooms is going to be the name. If you want to change it, you can change it here. If you're going to keep it same. There is record sharing. I'll not dwell into that for now. And then in this case, because rooms cannot be detached from one hotel building and put into another hotel, so we technically don't need any kind of reparenting, right? That's where the reparenting piece comes in. But there will be cases where we will need reparenting. So let's just hold on. We'll see that further. I'm going to click next. And want everybody to see the field for now. Say next, add it to the layout. And then I guess say next. So related list. So typically when you have a page layout, there's a detailed record and there are multiple related records to a particular detailed record. Those detailed record, related records are shown up in a list, and which is termed as a related list, and what's the label of the related list you want to show here. So in our case, it's going to be rooms. Fairly straightforward. It's going to show up on the hotel layout, right? So I'm going to, because I want to save a lot of clicks, I'm going to say save in new. So I created the hotel object, which means I've created a relationship, right? Now the next field is tariff, and tariff is going to be currency. So I'm going to choose a currency type field, say next, call it as tariff. Oops. Okay. Everything the same, because this is a numeric field or a currency field. I'm going to say length is 16, so at max it can be 18. And what I'm going to do is how many decimal places. So both these numbers typically should add up to 18, right? So I could have 16 values before the decimal place and 2 values after the decimal place in this case. I'm going to put a default value in this case just to say 00, right? I'm going to say next. Let's see if there's a, okay. I want to make sure that this is available to all the users. So I'm going to say next, and I'm going to add it to the room layout, right? But we still have a couple of fields to add. So we're going to say save and new. Let's go back. And now this time we're going to add the occupancy pick list field, because this is going to be a pick list field. And I want to restrict the options. I'm going to just create pick list, but in this case, there are no dependencies. Right? So I'm going to say occupancy. Say occupancy type. And then we say, I want to enter my own values. I could say single, it's a double, or a triple. And once we do that, we're going to choose a specific value. This time I'm going to say, I want to just make sure that the first value is the default value so that I reduce the overhead of my users. And then I go and say next. Of course, I don't want people to use my users to add any other values beyond the values that I have provided. And that's the reason why I choose the restrict pick list value option. I'll say next for field level security. I definitely want this field to be added to my page layout. And that's about it. I think we have our room object set up and detailed out with fields, right? So if you see, the fields are there. So there's a master detail relationship. There's a room number, which is of course the name field that we're using, and there is tariff, which is a currency field, and then there is an occupancy type, which is a pick list field. Right, now let's move on and quickly detail out the reservation field. So again, I'm going to go to object manager and I'm going to search for reservations. Now, reservations typically have very specific things, right? So if you typically talk about reservations or a room booking, you would ask specific questions. The first is, what was booked? Second is, who booked it? And the third is, when was it booked? Or what is the duration? So you need a start date and an end date. So let's just detail. So that's where the reservation thing comes in. But one of the key things over here is, reservation is a junction object between a contact, which is the person who booked the room, and the room that is being booked, right? Now in this case, this is a typical many-to-many relationship scenario, which means that one room could be booked by multiple people, of course on different dates, but at the same time, one person could also book multiple rooms, right? Which means that you have a many-to-many relationship over here. In this particular hotel room case, when there is either a master detail or a lookup, it is a one-to-many where the parent is one and the detail side would be many, which means that one hotel could have many rooms, right? That's what it is. So that is the reason why reservation needs to be a junction object, and this object will end up having two master detail relationships. So let me just go and create that. One of the key things to understand about the junction object is that when you're creating master detail relationships, you got to make sure that whichever object is the first object is something that dictates the visibility and the record sharing rights. So it's important that you are clear in the order in which you want to create your master detail relationships on a junction object. For now, let's not worry about that. Let's just go out and create new fields. So I'm going to say new. I want to say who booked the room. So I'm going to look. So I'm going to have a master detail here in this case. And in this case, say next. And I'm going to say it is related to a contact. Contact, say next. Keep everything the same. I want to keep the relationship name as reservations, and that's good enough. And then say next. Hey, one of the key things I missed out on mentioning over here is it would be very well possible that somebody has booked a room. Maybe you booked a room called 204, but something went wrong. There's a maintenance issue, and now, although your booking is for 204, the management, hotel management, wants to allocate 205 to you, which is typically a change. So in this case, there will be a need for reparenting, which means that a room booked for a contact could be reparented or reassigned to a different individual. Maybe there's a cancellation, So that is the reason where in this case, reparenting needs to be checked, right? Now let's just go. So allow reparenting checkbox purely just means that if I have a master record and a detail record, the detail record can be reparented and assigned a different parent, right? Once it is already assigned a parent. If you uncheck this checkbox, you will not be allowed to assign or reparent the existing detail record which has already been assigned a parent record. Right. So fairly simple, going next, say next, and then I'm adding this to the reservation layout. I'm going to say next, and then, I'm going to say the related list. Reservations will typically show up also on the contact page, right? Now, because it's a junction object and it has two relationships, it will all show up as related list on the detail pages of both the parent records. In this case, it'll show up as a detailed list on contact, and it'll also show up in the detailed as a related list on the detail page of rooms, right? Because those are the two key entities which will have a many-to-many relationships. So I'm going to say save and new. Now this time I'm going to create a new relationship with rooms, because the room also needs to be a master. So say room, we've already done that. Say next. Say room, keep the name. In this case, I'm just going to say room reservations just to differentiate this between, just to differentiate the relationship here. In this case, the room reservations could be different, right? And that's the reason why I'm going to say allow reparenting. Just say next. Okay. I want everybody to see it. Let's not worry about security for now. I'm adding it to the layout and say next. Now, so like I said, because in this case, this is the second object, we'll also have reservations show up on the related record of the room, on the detail page of the room object. So let's say save in new. So we've already created the room and contact relationship, master detail relationships for the reservation object. Now let's just go and detail it out with the start and end date, saying that from when. So let's pick a date field. We'd ideally pick a date time field, but yeah, I mean, in this case, we'll just pick a date field for simplicity. You could, in the real world, if you were modeling, you would typically pick a date time field. So let's say start date and keep everything the same. I can say today, just to make sure that I am populating today's date by default, right? These are standard functions which are available. So this just helps the user. I'm going to make sure everybody has access or is visible. This field is visible to them. And this also gets added to the reservation layout. Now as I save a new, and now I'm going to add an end date. Right, so this is again going to be a date field. This time it's going to be end date. And now in this case, I'm going to say today, but I'm saying today plus 3. So I can directly put in mathematical operations and it'll automatically compute. It says that what are the 3 days? I'll compute 3 calendar days from today and just add them, auto populate the end date field with 3 days from today, just to ease out the overall thing. I'm going to say next and just go through the entire wizard, not really changing a lot of things here, adding it to the layout, of course, and then I'm saying save. So now we have detailed out our reservation object and we've built relationships. And one of the key things you got to understand is if you're the person who understands things visually, there's also something called as a schema builder that's available. So you can simply go to Object Manager tab and there's the schema builder button. You can also access it from the setup menu. So just click the schema builder button, which gives you a GUI type of an interface, gives you a canvas. I'm going to clear all and I'm going to just choose the objects that we just created. So we created hotels, so we'll choose hotel, we created rooms, choose rooms, and then reservation. I'm going to choose a reservation and choose contact, because reservation is incomplete without a context. So we'll go to auto layout. Okay. And so you have a room, you have a reservation, right? So if you now compare the data model, so this gives you a more visual appearance to your data model. So people who can, you know, who understand or who can relate to the data model visually, Schema Builder is a tool for you. Of course, you can go and add build out objects and, you know, build out the same thing. The only thing is the entire wizard of being, you know, being able to add things to the page layout and you know, tabs is not available when you build out objects using Schema Builder. So that is exactly how you would end up building a data model on Salesforce. Use master detail relationships to build out relational objects, include field dependencies, right? All purely with a point and click thing. Let me just go out and create tabs so as to just give you a better understanding of how this all works. Don't really worry about the UI piece, right? So let's just see if we have an app already built. So I'm going to go out to, I'm going to say close and then say tabs. So I'm going to app manager build out quick lightning app. So I'm going to say hotel reservations. Keep everything stock standard. I'm going to say standard navigation. Just want to make sure that my form factors, which is desktop and phone, are supported. Say next. Say next. I'm going to choose my tabs very wisely. Do we have the tabs already for hotels and reservations? No, I don't think so. But we do have our contacts tab. So I'm going to go and add the contacts tab. Okay. I'll just say next. For now, of course, I want this to be available to all the profiles. For now, we'll just keep it simple. We just keep give access to the system administrator. Say save and finish. And my app is ready. Now, remember, we do not have hotels or reservations in this case. So I'm going to need to create tabs, right? And we're going to learn about this in our third day three episode. So let me just go and create tabs. Tabs. So there are already existing tabs because we have some of our objects already there. I'm going to just use them to create custom object tabs. Don't really be bogged down by the other term, other type of tabs. So I'm going to want a hotel tab so that I can easily access all the hotels available. And then these are themes that I can apply to a tab. Because it is a hotel, a building would be more relevant. So I'm going to quickly say building. You can choose any of your theme. It's just a more UI thing. I'm going to make sure that the tab is available to everybody, all profiles. In this case, I'm going to just add this tab to my hotel reservation app. See next. Now I also need to add reservations object. So reservation is more like computer. I'm going to add the computer theme. Take next. Make sure everybody sees my tab or it's default on. And then I only add this tab to my hotel reservation app and say save. So we have our tabs already ready. So let's just go back to our app manager. And then I'm going to already have my hotel reservation app. I'm just going to modify it slightly. Sorry about that. Okay, I'm just going to quickly modify the navigation and that's it. So we have hotels and reservations which I've added, which are added, right? But I do want the reservations to show up before the hotels, right? And the first thing that I want to do is I want to reorder my tabs so that I can enter a hotel, I can do a reservation. Rooms here don't really need a tab because technically rooms will not exist on their own, and that's the reason why we've purposefully not created a tab. Just say save. That's it. I'm gonna go back. Now, if I just switch tabs, I look for. I should see the hotel reservation application. So let me just go back and see how the. So it has three tabs. Hotels, reservations, and contacts. So I'm going to say hotels, create a new hotel. And now, if you see all the fields that you've added are there. So I'm going to say Hyatt. I'm going to say MG Road. Right. I'm going to, of course, say Maharashtra right now. And then I'm going to say Pune in this case. And I'm going to say save. That's how I could create a hotel record. But if you see over here, you don't really have rooms. So I'll quickly go and add rooms. I'll add a couple of rooms here. Now in this particular case, see the parent is already populated because I'm going via the related list. I'm going to add some tariff over here. I'm going to say $45, right? And if you see, it's already prefixed with the dollar sign. I say save. And then I say new, and I'm also going to add something for $65, right? It's double occupancy, good night. So now if you see, I did not type in the codes, but they have auto-generated, which means the auto number field is working. Now let's go and create a reservation. So like I said, I can create a reservation for somebody, but before that I just want to make sure that we have enough contacts in our system. Ideally, yes, we do. So let's just go back, create a new reservation. So let's search for an existing contact. I believe Andy is already there, so let's Andy wants a particular room. Now you can create a new room from here in this case. I'm going to search for showing me all the related lists. I'm seeing room 2. And if you see, the start and end dates are automatically populated. They're populated for 6th of August and it automatically added 3 days to 9th of August. I can go and customize this. I said, I don't want it for so many days. I just save. And that's what creates a reservation. Now I can navigate to the contact, to the room. Right, this is how a junction and object record is created. So this is typically how you can date model data on Salesforce and, you know, really build a relational data model. All right, thank you for that. Atul, over to you now.
So we have considered a hypothetical scenario, right? So the hypothetical scenario is something like this. So ABC Corporation is into hardware supplies, right? So they supplies hardware to various end users and various banks and IT companies and stuff like that. Right? So what what their requirement is, they want to track all the customers, right? Whoever wants to buy their product, they want to track their customers, right? And then they have a specific set of users in the Salesforce, and they want to make sure that one individual user from ABC Corporation is taking the ownership of each individual customer, right? So they want to have a lookup relationship from account, which is our customer, where we are going to store our customer data. So to specify which user is going to take care of this customer, we are going to specify this lookup relationship as a user. Then we are going to have a invoice object, okay? So invoice object is nothing but a parent object, okay? This object will tell you like how much is your total invoice amount, okay? How much amount you have paid, how much amount is due, when it is due, and the status of that invoice, okay? An invoice line item is the child object, okay? So invoice is a parent and invoice line item is a child. So invoice line item will have a detail like what hardware you have purchased, right? This hardware comes under which invoice, the description of a hardware, cost of a hardware, quantity of a hardware, right? And total price of that, that particular line item, right? So this is our sort of high level use case. And we will keep this building over a period of next, probably next 11 or 12 sessions. We will keep adding various aspects to this specific use case. And we will explore for this specific use case for what different Salesforce feature we can use and how Salesforce help us to, you know, easily set up the easily set up this ABC Corporation application on Salesforce.com. Okay. So this is our use case. So now let me share my browser. Jigar, Amit, are you guys able to view my screen?
Yes. Yes, we can.
Perfect. Okay. So what we will do is we will toggle between the PowerPoint presentation and this browser window to make sure that we cover all the points. Okay. So to create, so now first thing that we need to do is like we need to have, as per the requirement, our first point is to have the on an account object. Account is a standard object, right? So on that object, we want to assign a specific manager, right? The first thing we will do is like we will go into setup, and it automatically, when I go into setup, it automatically opens a new tab. So I believe Jigar have already already shown you guys how to create your own Salesforce DevOrg, and I believe all of you have tried that and have your own DevOrg. So I'm covering the flow for after the login. Okay, so when you log in, you'll see screen something like this. Okay, you can click on the right hand side setup a menu, and then it will take you to the new tab. Okay. On that tab, you will have an option to quick find. There we will search for object manager. So as soon as I type OBJ, it gives me option to navigate to object manager. There you can see all the objects or all the tables in the Salesforce, right? So those are all different objects available to us out of box. The one which you see __C are the custom which I have created, right? The one where you don't see __C are the standard object, right?
So by looking at their API name, you can easily figure out which one are standard and which one are custom. So we'll quickly go into account. And once we go into account, we can click on the fields and relationship. So that will show you all the fields from the account table or all the column in the account table. Okay. And our requirement is we want to create a new lookup. Okay. New lookup to the user table. So for that, you can simply click on a new. It will ask you different which type of data we want to create or which type of column we want to create. Okay. So right now we want to create a lookup relationship, lookup to which object? User's object. So I'll select lookup relationship and click next and related to users. Click next. It will ask me the field name, right? So what field name we want, it is our requirement is saying account manager, right? So I'll give a field name as a account manager. And when you press a tab on after entering label, it will automatically take the field name, which is the actual name that we will use when we create a formula and stuff like that. I have already field name as an account manager, so I have just added one to it. You don't need to do that. And then you can simply create next, click next. And it will ask you who will have access to this field. Okay, so we need to specify the field level security for this specific field. So Salesforce is really good in these terms. Like once you define your field, you need to tell who will have access to that field, and only those people will be able to either read or view that field. So you can make particular field as a read only, so that nobody will be able to edit that field. And you can select a field visibility if you want to show that particular field to everyone. So for now, we will keep it simple. We'll select the default and click next. Then it will ask you where do you want to show that new field that you are creating. Okay, so these are different layouts. So layout is nothing but I'll just quickly move to the other tab and go on the accounts tab and select one specific account. So here what you see is the layout of the account. Okay, so layout means how various things for account objects are arranged. Okay, so that is called as a layout. So we will say that I want to add this new field to the all the layouts. Okay, and you can just simply click save, and then it will allow you to, you know, sort of create this field. It will get saved into your metadata, and then you will be able to interact with that field. So I have already created this new field, okay, account manager, right? So when we I'll just create a new test record, or probably I will just edit the existing one. So account owner, I can see Jigar, right? So I can change the account owner, or I can do all the operations. So this is out of box becomes available to you, right? So you don't need to do anything special. You just define your data model, right? And then Salesforce take care of creating the presentation layer, handling validation, and then making sure that other peripheral activities are taken care of. So this is one of the very good capability of a Salesforce as a platform. So you just define your data model and then all other peripheral activity, which generally other programming languages where developer need to get involved and do a lot of handcrafted code writing in Salesforce, those things are out of box available to us. Okay. So the first requirement is address. Now we will go to the next requirement, which is creating the invoice object. So now this is the standard object that we have, right? So what if we want to create a new custom object? So we can go again to object manager and create and click custom object. And it will ask you the label of your custom object, right? So I will, for now, I will say invoice. I already have invoice, an invoice line item created for this demo. So I'll just say invoice one and it will automatically populate the rest of the things. It will ask me like, what if it's a plural, if there are multiple records, how should I refer it? Then Salesforce give us nice capability where we can select whether that particular object is available for reporting, track field history and stuff like that. So we will, in our upcoming sessions, we will go through them, but for today, just try and focus on creating objects, creating fields, and then different types of field. Okay, so we will create the object, and then the last checkbox is interesting. When you select this checkbox, it will give you a tab like this. Okay, so you can directly click on an invoice, right, and see all the existing invoice. So this kind of capability becomes out of box or seamless to the end user. We don't need to take any effort on this. If we just click save, it'll create a new object as a invoice one, and then it will create a tab for it like this, invoice and invoice line item. So I have already created this invoice object. So we'll just go and see that object. So steps are all same, the one that I have just shown you. And once we create the invoice object, we can go into fields and relationship option. And there we can create the fields that we need. So what we need for this demo is we need invoice number as a auto number field, right? So I have already created, when we create object, that time we need to select whether I want to use a name as a text field or auto number, right? So I have selected auto number, so automatically my invoice will get numbered. Okay, amount due, and this three amounts. So these are simple, right? So if I just want to show you a quick demo of creating a new field, I would just click create new, and I will create a simple text field. And I'll give a name, notes to account or AM. So account notes to AM. So if I want to pass any note to the account manager, I can just simply, pass using this field. So I'll select the length of field It'll select the API name will be automatically populated, and rest of the defaults I'll keep as it is. Click next. Visibility Android only I'll accept as it is, and just click save at the end. Okay. So now if we go into invoice table and create a new invoice, it will amount paid, I'll say 100, and due on 21st August, and this open invoice and notes to M. So this specific field is automatically becomes available to us, right? We did not write any code, did not took any extra effort to make this visible on our, to the end user, right? So I am operating here as an end user. So check for count is my note to the AM, and I'll just simply save this record. So this record will automatically get saved, right? And so this is how we can create the fields that we want, right? So we have a nice flow in the presentation. So you select your data type, right? What type of field you want to create. We have seen various data types. You can experiment with the different data types, right? Then you need to specify label. You need to specify length. How big is the field? You need to, if it is a pick list, you need to specify the pick list values. You need to specify description. So description is sort of optional, but it is really, really helpful. Okay. So like why you are creating that specific field. So that description you can specify. Help test is when you end user see your feed, this help test will help you end user to enter appropriate value, right? So if end user is sort of confused, he is not sure why this notes to AM field is there, then if I enter the detail about help test, then that will help end user. Okay, why that specific field is used. Set field visibility. We will talk about this in more detail, but this just on a high level. It will make sure that a specific field is visible to you, certain type of user, and it's hidden or it's read only to the other type of field user, other type of users. And then at the last, what we need to do is like we need to add that field on the page layout. Unless and until we add it to the page layout, that particular field will not be visible to anyone. Okay. So now we talked about the steps for creating objects. We have talked about creating steps for fields. We will also talk about creating the child object and their fields. Okay. So steps are almost same. So I'll just quickly walk you through how to create a new child object. Same steps will follow. Go into Object Manager, click create custom object, specify label, specify plural label, object name, and the record name, right? So record name is nothing but so for example, every user have a name, right? So same way record also have a name. So for example, opportunity name is like how you will, so opportunity in India, opportunity in US, opportunity in New Zealand, right? So the name of that particular record, how do you want to refer it? That you can specify. Data type, text or auto number. So if I select auto number, the record will automatically get incremented one by one. Here I need to specify display format. So in this case, what will happen is like record will be displayed as a I00001 and starting number, I can specify 100, whatever, right? So this is how we can create a new custom object, right? I'll just go back and show you the invoice line item. And to view the existing fields that I have created, I'll just click on the fields and relationship. So here, the special thing that I have done is I have created relationship invoices, okay? And the data type I have selected is master detail, okay? So as this is master detail, what will happen is our invoice object will become master. This object invoice line item will become child, and every invoice line item will need to be associated with one or the other invoice item. Okay. And with that, it will give us the capability of a rollup. So I can sum all the line items for specific invoice and then show them as a total. Okay. So we'll just simply go back to our demo. We have the invoice item. We'll go into invoice line item and create a new invoice line item. Line item name is, let's say, RAM 8. GB. So this is the line item name. Invoice I need to associate, so I'll select the invoice. And the description I'll give 8 GB RAM DDR3. So this is the rich text area field that I have selected. So as it is rich text area, I can do certain fancy things. I can, give a certain formatting, and I can specify the color and stuff like that. Okay. So this becomes very interesting for the user, right? So we can do a lot of interesting things with different data type. So cost price, I'll say 100, and quantity as a 1, and click save. Okay. And so this is my first line item for this invoice. I'll clone this record and I'll say now instead of 8 GB, I'll say 16 GB, and RAM 16 GB, and save. Okay. So I have created two records, each with the cost price as 100, right? Now let's go to invoice and see. Does our roll-up summary...
Sorry?
Atul, we can't really see your screen. I think you need to share it again. Can you do that, please?
Share. Are you able to see?
Yes, I can see it now. Yeah, you can go.
Okay. Okay. So what I was talking about is share computer. One second. The sharing option is share. Okay. You're still able to see my screen, right?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. So I have created two invoice line items, right? And then each I have given a different price, same price. Let's give some different price. So let's say this is for, not for 100, this for 150 USD. So if we go back to our invoice record, we should see 250 as the total amount, right? So how this is happening is we have created the roll-up summary field on the invoice object, right? So invoice object. Fields and relationship. And oops, this is invoice line item. Invoice object, fields and relationship. And this is the amount total field as a roll-up summary, right? So we can do a lot of fancy things with different data types, and those become you know, like very interesting for real business use cases. So one, that simple use case that I have shown, you can try it same way with the student and their subject marks. So you can create student table, you can create a various subject records and their marks, and then you can have a result on the parent student table, right? So you can try the various roll up summary types. So count is for counting how many childs we have. Min and max are like minimum, getting the minimum value out of all child and maximum value out of all the child records. And sum is the one that we have shown. And then we need to specify the field on which we want to do this sum or min max count operation. Okay. So this is for the master detail relationship. So we will quickly see one interesting field and then we will open for question and answer. So we are already on the invoice object, right? We have the fields like amount due, right? Which is the formula field. And its type is currency. So I will simply try and edit that. So what this field does is, it is a formula, right? It calculate value automatically. We have the total value, right? And then from a total value, we want to subtract the amount which is already paid. So if we do this subtraction, whatever amount remains is the amount due, right? So if we go on our invoice object, our total invoice amount is $250. Out of that, $100 is already paid. And due to that, the remaining amount is 150. So if I change certain values here, right? So 1110. Notice that the amount due automatically changes. So these are different type of things that we can do with the master detail relationship and formula fields. So we can do like formulas between various like cross object and stuff like that. So I think we have covered most of the points. So these are the trailhead links for you to go through, and these are some of the additional.
Atul. Yes. I believe you're sharing your presentation, but we can't see the slide deck.
Oops. One second. new share. So share, yeah. So this is the link for the Trailhead module. Some of the additional report, additional resources for you to follow through, some of the help documentations and stuff like that. And with that, we would like to open the forum for the questions.
Yeah, Atul, can you show that audience builder?
Schema builder.
Schema builder.
If we go in setup, I think we are already on a set. So you are able to view my screen, right?
Yes, I am looking at the question slide deck right now.
Why it's doing that? Okay, so if I go in setup, so you are able to view the browser window now, right?
Yes.
Perfect. So if I go in setup and go to schema, search for a schema builder. So it opens a really nice UI for us. For now, we can say clear all. So it will clear all the everything that is there on the screen, and then we can select the object of our interest, right? So we want to sort of see the account object. We want to see the invoice object and invoice line items as well. And so we can do a lot of fancy things using the schema builder, right? So as you can see, you know, the relationship which are defined are directly available to you on the screen. You don't need to do anything special, right? And this interface is really nice. In the other databases that I had worked with, I had to create this manually on paper and then, you know, translate that into the database terms, right? In Salesforce, it becomes very easy. So we can even sort of play with this. We can create new fields and we can, you know, sort of interact with this. So if I sort of click on any specific field, it shows me all the details related to it. I can make certain changes, those I want, and click save. So it will automatically get, you know, like affected in your underlying data model. So, yeah, with that, we would like to open the forum for the questions.
So, Atul, I think there are quite a few questions in the chat window.
Okay.
If you want to just pause your screen share and just, you know, talk a little bit, look at the questions and talk a little bit about them, hopefully that will be great. But one of the things that I could sense, and you know, what the people want to know is a little bit more about one, it was the field creation process and the summary field, the roll up summary fields, and why is roll up summary fields do not work with lookup relationships, and why do they only work with master detail? So if you could throw some light on that, that'd be great.
Sure. So we have two, so there are two different mechanisms to relate between two different tables, right? There are two different ways to link
two records from the different table, right? And one of them is lookup and the other is master detail. So master detail is mainly used for when we want that tight bounding, right? When the child record cannot exist without the parent record. So for example, invoice line item, right? So you cannot have just one single line item as your invoice, right? So there, even if you have single line item, you will have to create the parent invoice to make a business sense out of it, right? So when we have this sort of relationship, we use the master detail relationship between two objects or two table. When we need loosely type relationship, right? So for example, account manager can be assigned to invoice, or it can be like in at an indecisive state where we don't know like where this account, which account manager will be assigned to this specific customer, right? So that value can be null, but then invoice, customer invoice will be always there, right? So when we have this loosely type of reference, there we use the lookup relationship. When we have really strong type coupling, there we use master detail relationship. So I hope that answers the question.
And then there was this question which talked about why rollups can't really be created with lookup and why only a master detail.
Very, very good question. So whoever have asked that question, you're really on a right track to learning, I would say. So when we have this tight coupling, right? So that gives you a capability. The parent gets the control over the all the child record, and with that capability, you have the option of rolling up the values in the child, right? When we have a loose relationship between two different objects or two different tables, we don't have that capability. We are not sure whether that record will be out of box, like that record will be there, whether there will be a child record or not, right? So for that reason, there is no roll up. So it's come from the more from a technical implementation point of view, right? So if you don't have a children, how could you calculate the parent, like something on the parent, right? So for that reason, only master detail supports the roll-up summaries, and lookups don't support parent like roll-up summaries because the relationship is loose.
And I think there was a request. I think people are getting it's a little bit difficult for people to understand the difference between a master detail and an invoice, and a lookup relationship. So if you could just give an example, one for probably master detail and one for lookup, that'd be great.
Sure. Master detail, so for example, opportunity, right? So opportunity is the object we have in Salesforce, and opportunity is always related with a particular account, right? We cannot have opportunity hanging. So opportunity will always have a parent. So that is kind of a tight coupling, I would say, where for opportunity to exist, we must have the parent account, right? We cannot have opportunity which does not have any customer, right? So That is the, I would say, a good example of a master detail. Lookup is like, so for example, a case can have a manager assigned to it, right? Or it can be a blank. So user relationship is sort of optional. And whenever that optional thing comes in picture, we use a lookup relationship.
So thanks for that, Atul. By the way, there's one great good example presented by Amit also. So, you know, just like, for example, students cannot really exist without a college. So college becomes the parent and the students going to that college become the child record. So that's another example of a master detail, right?
Right.
Similarly, if I'm looking at a question and an answer and the options options to an answer, right? If I'm modeling that, an answer could have multiple options. It may or may not have options, right? That could be an example of a lookup. So it's, you know, it's those are the things. I mean, you know, as you kind of go ahead and do it, probably you get a better hang of what, when to use a lookup versus when to use a master detail.
Correct.
Okay. I think there's a question around page layout and compact layout. So, Rishabh, I would recommend you to, you know, hold up your enthusiasm. I'm glad that you're asking these questions. We have a session only dedicated to this particular, you know, the UI thing. So just hold on to your enthusiasm and we'll definitely answer that in the upcoming sessions. I think with that, probably we've overshot our time, but nevertheless, as long as the learning is happening, you know, it's a great experience for everybody. So thank you once again, Atul, thank you for that great session. And guys, thank you for all the enthusiasm and being so patient in spite of the technical glitches. So thank you once again. If you do have follow-up questions, please feel free to post the questions on our Twitter handle or on our website, which is Apex Hours, and we will be more than happy to answer each and every question that you have, right? So I'm sure we may not have covered all the questions in the process, but yeah, just put it on our Twitter handle or our website, I'd prefer, and we'll definitely provide detailed answers to your questions. So thank you once again, everyone, for joining in. Stay hungry, stay foolish, and keep learning and keep blazing the trails. So here's Student Apex Hours. And this is Jigarsha. We're signing off for the day. We'll be back tomorrow with an interesting session, which will cover and unravel some new facets about Salesforce. Just a quick thing that I'd like to mention, you know, for people who've joined us today and, you know, did not join us yesterday, you would have to go out and register individually for your session. So I'm just going to quickly share my screen and just walk you guys through. So all you've got to do is go to use the link. It's bit.ly /regstdapexhrs. That's the link. It's there on our Twitter handle as well. So, you know, just go to the link. That will bring you to this page that you're seeing right now on the screen, and make sure that for tomorrow's session, which is about the user interface, you just choose the I'm sorry, not tomorrow, but it's on August 5th, which is a Monday. Apologies for that. So to make sure you choose August 5th and register so that you are able to you keep joining us for the upcoming session. So every session you got to make sure that you select the appropriate date and join, register and join our sessions. The next session will be again a continuation of today's project, and we will be talking about how you can customize user interfaces in Salesforce. So thank you once again. With that, I'll take your leave. Good night, everyone. Have a safe day and enjoy your remaining of day and weekend. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.